I don't know about primordial slime, but you know, we did develop out of an arts community in the San Francisco Bay Area that was always interested in voice and always interested in how different people's stories could be told. I ran a theater for 10 years from 1983 to 93, and that theater company's interest was a lot in contemporary storytelling, what we called solo performance. One of my collaborators was a man named Dana Atchley, and Dana was a video producer and also a graphic designer of great quality and very interested in personal storytelling. His obsession was personal archival material. He had every image he ever took from his first Brownie camera until he was, you know, 50 million miles down the road as an American cinematographer and artist. And what was obsessive in particular is he knew where everything was. And he not only had his own images, but he had five generations of intact family archive that went all the way back to 1865 daguerreotype photos of his great-great-grandfather. Anyway, Dana's show Next Exit became a kind of symbol of grounded new media and stories about people and their lives. And as we toured the show in the early 1990s, a lot of people wanted to make stories just like Dana's. But it required very expensive equipment that meant, you know, people would have to spend hundreds, if not thousands of dollars to make a very short piece. But in the early 90s, we were introduced to new media, in particular to digital video. And we began to move his show, which included a lot of video clips, from first tape to interactive laser disc. Finally, we put it onto digital video on a hard drive. That show was brought to the American Film Institute in 1993 in February as part of one of their national video festivals. And as part of his performance, he put on a three-day workshop that I participated in. And that first story, which is called Tanya, was by a maker named Monty Hollis. And I'd like to share that story for you to get an idea of what the very first digital story looked like. So this is Tanya from 1993 workshop at the American Film Institute.
I never had a lot of friends, not really. The truth is I didn't even know what one was. Growing up, I was shy and confused friendship with popularity. Last year I met Tanya and we became the kind of friends that most friends are, acquaintances. She knew she had AIDS and would die soon, but facing death gave her more strength to live. She had no place to leave her girls and wanted to find them a good home. Tanya also wanted to start an organization to help parents like herself die in peace, knowing their children were loved and cared for. She also needed a real friend. Tanya got a lot of attention the minute she told her story, as if the world had been waiting for her. I stood by and watched in amazement. A few months later, she couldn't do much on her own, and for all her efforts, she felt she had only accomplished one thing. She found a real friend, and it was me. And I couldn't let her dreams die with her. The other night, Tanya told me to lay my head down next to hers. She wanted to tell me a secret. Monty Fay, don't forget, all we got is where we're going. I couldn't believe she knew my middle name.
Oh, I hate to see her go. Will this circle be unbroken?
Now, what I like about that film is the structure of it. It's a very short piece of writing. It's maybe 150 words. It uses 16 images, one very small piece of film. But inside the story, you see all of the elements of great storytelling. You see a hook in asking the question of what is friendship. She never understood friendship, and she confused friendship with popularity. But there's also a payoff at the end that's very powerful about when she asks by her friend says, Monty Fay, all we got is where we're going. And then there's a wonderful beat, and she says, I couldn't believe she knew my middle name. And that payoff about friendship, about connection, about loss, becomes enormously emotionally powerful. But like many digital stories, they're not essentially personal. They're about another subject. This was meant to be a documentary about Tanya Shaw, this amazing woman who was doing education around AIDS and families, and what mothers and parents do with their children after they die from a terminal disease. As such, it has a different kind of social and political depth that I think from the very beginning was a hallmark of our interest in our work. From the very first workshop, by 1994, we opened the San Francisco Digital Media Center. And that was meant to be a community arts workshop for young people, old people, educators, local activists to tell stories about the work that they did. And by 1998, we had begun to train other people in our practice. This digital storytelling workshop model became the thing that you'll hear more about, but it was a form for a lot of people to get engaged in creating new media. And in 98, we were invited by the University of California at Berkeley to come and settle in there to work with their faculty in looking at the way digital storytelling could be used in K-12 education. But we used that as a launching pad, not only for work around the United States, but increasingly around the world. And by 2000, we had come over to Europe several times, but we did a training project with the British Broadcasting Corporation in Wales, and they started a program called Capture Wales that ended at lasting 7 years, capturing some 800 stories in every small town in Wales and creating really a large movement in Wales and throughout the UK and increasingly in other parts of Europe and the world that was interested in what the BBC did. And that work in some ways inspired us to have the kinds of conversations we've had in any number of environments of professional use of digital stories. Most of our work was meant for very private use or small community presentations, but people became very interested in how it could be used for museums, for broadcast organizations, for websites, etc. Our work, having grown from education, has become focused in the last period principally in social service areas. So we've been very interested in the way that you can use this to bring the voices of the silent out. And a program brought to us by our program director, Amy Hill, in 2000, has become kind of the hallmark of our current decade of work. That program is called Silent Speaks at silentspeaks.org. And that's the work where you'll see us working around any number of issues from gender-based violence to foster care to the effects of public health on cognitive, supporting cognitive behavior and different issues of disabilities, both visible and invisible, as well as a lot of work we've been doing in the developing world around human rights and around public health issues in the developing world. So I hope that's a good background for our work, and I know you're going to enjoy the rest of this presentation, and I look forward to hearing back from you. If you want to contact me, you can just email joe@storycenter.org. Thank you a lot.